You are listening to a free version of Majority Report with Sam Steeder. To support this show and get another 15 minutes of daily program, go to majority.fm, please.
The Majority Report with Sam Steeder, where every day is casual Friday. That means Monday is casual Monday. Tuesday, casual Tuesday. Wednesday, casual hump day. Thursday, casual Thurs. That's what we call it. And Friday, casual Shabbat. The Majority Report with Sam Steeder.
It is Friday, October 21st, 2016. My name is Sam Steeder. This is the four-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live from Las Vegas, Nevada. At the Mass Torts Conference 2016. It is casual Friday, but when I am on the road at this conference, we do things a little bit differently. Not quite as casual, although we'll get there, I think. Yesterday... politics dominated the news. I mean, electoral politics. We had a lot of politicos here. Been a lot of people here in Vegas and at this conference that I don't normally see and get a chance to talk to. Some really interesting folks, frankly, and who are outside of the law. And no, I don't mean to say that they're outlaws. I mean, they're not lawyers involved in tort law. And but today on the program, we should have it's always a little bit flying by the seat of my pants here, but we have at least a couple of attorneys who are going to come by, talk about some product liability. We have an attorney who came by who was targeted by all appearances on political grounds and has an amazing story of representing himself in this criminal case and winning, which is contrary to everything I was ever told by my dad about representing yourself. But before we get to that, I did an interview yesterday with Gavi Mairone. He is the founder of MM Law, which is a law firm that pursues private human rights law by representing victims of terrorism. This can be American victims of terrorism. It could be, as we talk about in his interview, Yazidis in Iraq. And he pursues banks and right now oil companies for knowingly funding, providing services to organizations that end up committing terrorist attacks. It was a long interview. I didn't have time to cut it all up in the way that I probably should have. But it is it's fascinating because he was telling me, I don't know if we even got this on mic, but afterwards, that he ran into a Treasury official once on an airplane who told him that one of his suits has completely altered the amount of and the means in which terrorists were getting financed. So an interesting story and practice that is atypical of what we usually get here. But we're going to go with that now. We're going to take a quick break and then Gavi Mairone. Continuing our coverage at the Mass Torts Conference 2016, joining me now is Gavi Mairone. He's from, what is the firm you're from?
MM Law.
MM Law. And Your field of law is pretty niche, I guess.
Yes, it is.
Tell us what that is.
It's a niche, really, that I helped actually create. And the idea is to represent victims of crimes against humanity or terrorism, genocide, and hold accountable the financiers and profiteers for those crimes. So, for an example, if a bank has been money laundering for Al-Qaeda, then I would bring the lawsuit against that bank for enabling Al-Qaeda and financing the attack that resulted in their injuries.
What are the elements that you need to prove to make a case like that, to win a case like that?
Sure. So there's actually three different laws, and the plaintiff's groups are divided into three different categories. There's American citizens. There's American citizens, soldiers, and employees of the U.S. government against state-sponsored terrorism like Iran. And then there's non-American citizens. So under American citizens, which is our typical case, against private actors, you need to show that the bank or the oil company, and I've sued all of those, knowingly or intentionally provided material support or financing to a terrorist organization, that terrorist organization perpetrated the crime, resulting in the damage, and that it was foreseeable, which shows aiding and abetting, it was foreseeable to the bank that by financing or providing services or material support to that organization would result in the attack.
Okay, two things. The knowingly, is it knowingly and intentionally?
Or.
Okay. What is the distinction there? And then I want to get to the reasonably, I guess, perceived that an attack, not a specific attack.
Right.
Right? Okay, so just let's start with that.
Okay, so it's taking your second question first. There's actually several different sections under the Anti-Terrorism Act. One of them relates to FTOs, which are foreign terrorist organizations. And actually that provision was enhanced by the recent JASTA. And what an FTO is an organization designated by the Secretary of State. And if you give one penny of support or anything to an FTO, you become liable, and you knew that it was an FTO, or you knew that the recipient engages in terrorism or may engage in terrorism, you become liable under U.S. law for every American who's damaged or harmed by that FTO, period, within a reasonable time stretch.
How do you prove that a bank executive or a bank as an institution knew that this group was an FTO?
Well, large banks, you know, have access to the United States designations. So, I mean,
Al-Qaeda should have known?
Right. But you're deemed to know. Let's say if you were the largest bank in the world, or the second or the third largest bank in the world, there's no, and you're doing business in countries like Iran, Saudi Arabia, wherever, there's no chance in the world that you don't know, for instance, Al-Qaeda's designated terrorist organization. A large oil company, too, in the United States that settled with us after we won motions to dismiss and summary judgments, where they were paying kickbacks to Saddam Hussein under the oil for food regime. So they were illegally buying oil and depositing the money in the escrow account to the UN, and then they were paying millions of dollars in kickbacks, tens of millions of dollars, under the table through third parties. The allegation was we traced the money from, let's say, Texas or California all the way to Cyprus, to Lebanon, to Jordan, to the West Bank, to the Gaza Strip, to the families of 22 suicide bombers, which Saddam Hussein had published that he was going to pay $25,000 in incentive to the family that produces every suicide bomber. And we actually found the trail all the way to the end line. So with that amount of evidence, of course it was contested, but we won the motions to dismiss and we won a summary judgment, and then they settled. So that's an example.
Because the oil company doesn't want the publicity from a case that...
Under the statute, there's treble damages. So it's reputational damage, and it could be massive amount. If the jury came back with a $10 million verdict for each client because of the horrendous terrorists, that's $30 million per each client. You know, it could have been massive, so they cut their losses. That's an example. We have a case right now pending on this very issue against Chevron.
Well, what is the case regarding Chevron? Specifically kickbacks to Saddam
Hussein?
Yes, exactly
this. Chevron admitted to the kickbacks, or they admitted that they wire transfers or something, and was fined $20 million. They paid that fine, which to them is like...
nothing.
Right. But they transferred over $20 million under the table to Saddam, and they knew it. We even have testimony of floor traders who knew that there was a shell company, third party, and the profit was being paid supposedly to the shell company, but the traders were over the head of the shell company negotiating with the Saddam regime on how much the kickback should be.
So now, how do you, in that instance, are you acting upon findings by the U.S. government for that case to materialize? Or are you actively going out there and looking for companies, in this instance of Saddam Hussein, that would have kicked money back?
No, we start with what becomes published. So the United Nations published a report on the violations of the oil for food. It was headed by the Volcker Commission. And in their report, it was thousands of pages long, and we go through there, and one by one, we track. Most of the companies involved were Russian companies, French companies, etc. But there's a number of American companies. From there, what happened is then we looked at the record. We found that some American companies entered into agreements with the United States government, deferral prosecution, signed statements, and paid fines. So whatever is published, and there... the United States government, unfortunately, covers up for these companies in the sense that they pay the money and then they just report, they hide many of the facts, but just, you know, the overall. So we know. Then there was a couple people were prosecuted in the United States, went to jail for facilitating those wire transfers or doing them. So we went to all the transcripts, met with U.S. attorneys, and got the underlying exhibits from those criminal trials. On the other side, because of our capabilities of research in Arabic, Farsi, and other things, we were able to trace the money all the way to the suicide bomber's family. So we have to link the whole thing up. From San Francisco, the money went, and how did it get all the way to this guy's living room, this family? And so it's a huge amount of research. So it's all of what you said. It's meeting with our contacts at the CTC, which is the Combating Terrorism Center in West Point, which we have a very good relationship with. It's with the Israeli army that we've been given access to literally millions of documents that we spent 7 years every day sending three of my staff there to go through one by one pages of millions of documents to put together the whole trace. So it's a huge effort.
What other are all the cases that you've been dealing with primarily a function of that relationship with Saddam Hussein?
No.
Because I know you're dealing with... you're representing Yazidis as well.
We're working on a case for Yazidis against ISIS. But another example is I represent 4,000 clients of who are Kurds. 3,000 were killed by chemical weapons, and the others were injured. And we brought a lawsuit in Paris against three French companies who illegally supplied the chemical weapons precursors. And there's two West German, now German companies that we want to also sue. It's a little bit different under Germany's laws because they built the largest chemical weapons factories in the world for Saddam, not only during the Cold War, but while he was deploying those weapons against the Iranians. 400 Kurdish villages and towns were attacked with chemical weapons, and these guys kept supplying the precursors to Saddam during this period. And so... So that's a different example. We represent...
let me ask you, I mean, wasn't the American government also supplying weapons of that kind to the Saddam regime?
No. The American government is against proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, period. But the United States government it was both good and bad in this story. George Shultz, Secretary of State, was out there putting huge pressure on the West German government to cause their companies to cease and desist because there's tremendous intel, and we've got that. On the other hand, the Department of Defense, Caspar Weinberger then, was at that time putting pressure on the State Department so that in the UN, the Secretary General was trying to issue a report every month that Iran was using chemical weapons against, that Iraq was using chemical weapons against Iran, and the United States government was putting pressure to suppress that report because actually the United States government is also supporting Iraq against Iran in that war. And so every announcement of the UN Secretary General always said, we call on both sides not to use chemical weapons. But in fact, Iran never used chemical weapons, and only Iraq did. So United States, on one hand, was giving a wink and a green light to Saddam, but it did not supply those weapons. On the other hand, was trying to stop all supply of those weapons.
What constitutes, in terms of, and this is all based, all of these actions that you're bringing are a function of U.S. statutes, yes?
For America, yes. Well, if it's in a U.S. court, yes. In France, it's French statutes, as an example.
And so what constitutes, is the definition of terrorism and what type of entity can commit terrorism, is that a function of the statute?
Yes.
And does that change from country to country?
Probably.
Generally
speaking, all countries in the world define terrorism more or less the same way, with a word here or there difference. And that is, it's an act of violence which may threaten human life, which appears to be intended to coerce or intimidate a population or a government.
So theoretically, let's say the Iran-Contra deal, the U.S. provides funds for the Contras, right? Based on that definition, theoretically, the Contras...
if they committed such atrocities, sure. This law was passed in 1996 in the Clinton administration, so that would have predated that.
But can you go backwards on that or no?
No, and there's also statute of limitations. So.
Right. Are there ever cases where we're sending funds, right? Theoretically, or I think it seems, clear that there's reason to believe that we funded some groups in Syria in the civil war, right? And al-Nusra,
yes,
terrorist organization.
Yes, that is part of al-Qaeda. I don't know that we funded them. The United States tries very carefully, and these designations impact how the United States deals. That's true. Under the Anti-Terrorism Act, you can only sue private actors, so you wouldn't be able to bring a lawsuit not against Iran and not against the United States, not against any country. But if someone wanted to claim that the United States was committed a crime against humanity, they can come to the United States and file such a suit, I guess. I've not really thought about that.
What are the implications of JASTA? Just tell people what JASTA is and what it was passed, vetoed, and then the veto was overridden just, I guess, 3 or 4 weeks ago.
Almost unanimously. Unanimous in the Senate.
Yes, 99 to 1, I think it was.
The House also by a huge margin. So JASTA is Justice and Accountability for Survivors of Terrorists, or Sponsors of Terrorism. And it applies only to terrorist attacks which occur on U.S. soil. So we're talking only about 9/11, Boston Marathon, Fort Hood, most likely. And what JASTA says is that, if anyone, including a state actor, assisted in perpetrating an act of terrorism on U.S. soil against Americans, that they can be sued under the Anti-Terrorism Act. Okay? normally you cannot sue a country. Every country in the world recognizes sovereign immunity, including the United States, of course. And then the United States, like most countries, especially all democracies, passes laws where you, under what condition can you sue the United States for discrimination or for whatever, okay? And all democracies have laws permitting their own citizens to sue their own government for violation of a constitution or a law or something. But every country has an interest in not letting its citizens sue any foreign country so that that foreign country won't let its citizens sue the United States.
Right. You don't want to start reciprocity.
So that's international law.
Right. Okay.
Right. So that's international law. Everyone has an interest. In 1996, Congress and the Clinton administration passed a law called the Foreign Sovereign Immunity Act, which straightened up. There was a whole mess in all the proceedings for all kinds of reasons, but it clarified under what instance you could sue a foreign sovereign in the United States. So the easiest example is foreign sovereign enters a contract to buy wheat. It breaches, it doesn't pay for it, and the farmers want to sue it, and the Soviet Union was saying, hey, we're a government, you can't sue us. So if it's a breach of a commercial contract under the Foreign Sovereign Immunity Act, you can sue. President Clinton added, and this was supported bipartisan, that if there's a designated state sponsor of terrorism, meaning designated by the United States government under executive order or State Department, then victims of terrorism who are United States citizens may bring an action against that foreign government. So who's designated? Iran, Syria, North Korea was, it's no longer, Cuba, and Sudan today. In the past, also Libya and Iraq were also designated at one time. So, but other countries that are not designated, even if realistically they actually support terrorism, like, let's say, perhaps Saudi Arabia, perhaps Pakistan, Qatar, they're not designated, no one can sue them. In 2008, George Bush signed an amendment to that saying that not only U.S. citizens, but employees of the U.S. government, which then opened the door for my clients in the U.S. Embassy bombing, who are foreign nationals, who were also killed in the bombing. Okay? And then JASTA opened the door further by saying, if there's an attack on U.S. soil, even supported by a foreign government who's not designated, the victims, like 9/11, like Boston Marathon, they could bring that lawsuit here in America against that foreign sovereign.
So JASTA had the impact of widening the scope of players that could be considered liable under certain conditions.
For attacks on U.S. soil.
Under that specific condition.
There's another small provision in JASTA which generally helps everyone, not just on attacks on U.S. soil. And that's that Congress clarified that aiding and abetting liability under the Anti-Terrorism Act was intended to be imposed by Congress for any action against a designated foreign terrorist organization, FTO.
What are the chances of this opening the door to a certain amount of reciprocity? I mean, because if I am a Shia in Iraq, and a Sunni attack on my family, or arguably vice versa. Say, like, well, you know, the U.S. government dropped a lot of money here, and is there potential there for a suit there? I mean.
Look, there's potential with or without, okay? And lawsuits are brought all the time. A lawsuit was brought against Rumsfeld for being a war criminal, you know, and others, okay? So in the United States, as all other governments, is big enough to defend itself against lawsuits when they're frivolous. If the United States actually harms someone, okay, we bombed a wedding, let's say, with a drone.
Right.
Okay? Well, and I'm a very proud to be an American citizen, and I'm a human rights lawyer, and I would expect my government, in that case, to at least say I'm sorry and pay the family some kind of compensation to help them out. You know, you can't unwind the bomb. So, and I think our government does that, you know? So if our government doesn't do that, I think personally that it should. And if someone wants to hold the United States government accountable and it's not a frivolous case, I don't have a problem with that because I think ethically and morally, right. Anyway, we should.
Of course. And how would what would your speculation be as to whether or not U.S. courts would allow that to proceed?
Which, a frivolous claim?
No, no, not a frivolous claim. But, I mean, we have examples of droning of wedding parties in the past couple of months, actually. And my understanding is that the payments, you know, we have deaths of Syrian citizens. U.S. deaths somewhere between 800 to 1,000, 1,200 I've seen. I know that we pay Syrian soldiers when we have killed Syrian soldiers. My understanding is the payments to Syrian civilians not as forthcoming. How would a U.S. court now, particularly in light of JASTA, would they entertain a case like that?
No, because JASTA applies to an act of terrorism directed against Americans on U.S. soil. I think, and I'm not an expert in this, that I think, though, that U.S. law shields the Department of Defense and our military for any claims committed during warfare. Mm. So legally, I'm not sure that anyone can legally bring a claim against the United States that would survive in court. However, I do believe that the United States has certain procedures for people filing claims and trying to resolve those claims. And I think ethically and morally, right. I would be very proud of our country that it does that. And I'm sure everybody would. I'm sure veterans would. Because our intention in Iraq and in Afghanistan was never to harm the people. It was to fight terrorism. So, you know, and if I look at England as an example, under the European Human Rights Act, they've been inundated with claims against British Army and soldiers. I mean, huge amount. It's gotten to be so massive, and most of them frivolous. I mean, I would say almost all of them frivolous. But it's gotten to be so massive there that recently the government announced that they're going to pay for lawyers for all soldiers, which could be like a colonel, a major, anybody. I mean, it could even be a private. But normally, you know, because they see there have been private actions being filed against individuals, soldiers. So the government's going to at least handle their legal fees because it's just overwhelmingly frivolous claims. So, yeah, but back to JASTA and so on. Right. On the one hand, if I'm saying, look, there's some foreign government that has funded al-Qaeda, and there's evidence of it. And, you know, at the time of the 9/11 bombing. And on the other hand, I'm worried that, okay, there could be even more lawsuits, because there are lawsuits, more lawsuits filed in Iran. Good for you. Go do that. You know, file a lawsuit in Sudan and then try to collect it in Europe or in America, right, against our assets. You know, it's a drop in the bucket for the United States government to defend itself on those things. And on the other hand, all these people whose lives have been destroyed and decimated to prevent them. I mean, part of the problem with Saudi Arabia, which led to this, is they have probably several thousand princes who do nothing in the government. It's a monarchy. All those princes have immunity under sovereign immunity. So if those princes, some of them are al-Qaeda supporters.
Right.
Okay? And our courts prevented the 9/11 clients from even bringing any one of them into court, which is ridiculous. I mean, it's one thing to sue Rumsfeld, and it's another thing to sue... I mean, I have a friend, Mohammed, who lives in South Beach, and he's a prince, and he goes once a year to Saudi Arabia during Ramadan. We're good buddies, but he would have immunity. I mean, he does nothing, and he has no government function. But if Mohammed's got some half-cousin somewhere that's a member of the al-Qaeda financing club, they both have immunity. It doesn't make any sense. So that's, I think, what JASTA was trying to do.
Can you talk about your Yazidi?
Yes.
How do you go about with something like that? I mean, is this going to trace back? It's going to be a similar dynamic.
Well,
right?
Yes. Well, how is Daesh or ISIS, how is it financing itself? I mean, I can show you video clips. We now have hundreds and hundreds of video clips where they're taking responsibility for all kinds of things, not just the ones that come on TV where there's a beheading. But when you see the amount of weaponry used, and not only by them, by Iranian-backed Shia terrorist groups, which the United States Army calls special criminal groups, not militias, okay? And I have over 150 videos from them killing American soldiers. So when you you have to figure, okay, how are these special groups financed and how is Daesh? And when you begin to take it apart, you see that it's hundreds of millions of dollars. It's not $1 million. It's hundreds of millions. I mean, it's kind of like the budget of a state. You have to not only buy the weapons and do the training, recruitment, hospital care for wounded, welfare care for all the
housing,
food, housing,
right.
Uniforms, the taking care of the families, the fallen. I mean, it's an astounding budget, which means what? The scale of the terrorism being directed right now could never happen without the money. And if you go Osama bin Laden, how did he become the head of Al-Qaeda? Because he brought money.
Right.
There was in Philadelphia in 1994 a meeting of all the heads of Hamas. The FBI videotaped it. I have the videotape. In 1994, they all sat to figure out how do we unwind the peace process. Almost the three-day meeting dealt 90% of finance, setting up charities, front charities. The largest charity that they had was called the Holy Land Foundation in Texas. All those guys today are sitting in jail as a result of a lawsuit that we brought, civil lawsuit against them for the death of one American teenager, okay? And we proved that that charity was actually a front for Hamas, okay? So financing is the front of all these things. The scale of the terrorism could not happen but for the money. How do they get the money? Well, some of it is from crazy donors, you know, who are ideologically in tune. Forget about those for a second. But most of it is from just banks, corporations who can turn a profit and don't give a damn what the money that they're pumping in is used for. So an oil company that wants to buy cheap oil from ISIS is more than happy because we're going to make a big profit. And they've never, ever, ever, until I brought the case in the Air Bank, there's never been a case where anybody was really held accountable to the damage that their profits created. And I'm saying that without those profits, there would not have been the scale of the terrorism.
How does an oil company, like, I mean, what are the mechanics of that? Like, where the oil company is just sitting around the boardroom and they're saying, like, you know what? We can get our wholesale oil, our crude, for 75% less a barrel. I don't know what the figures are, but let's send Jim to go talk to Daesh. I mean, how does that? What are the mechanics? I mean, do you find that in discovery? And
yes, who in Daesh is selling oil? Okay, the entire senior level of the Ba'athist regime of Saddam Hussein became part of Daesh, not because they're religious, but they were being oppressed and persecuted. And they were being persecuted by who? By Iran, really. Because Iran is controlling the central government in Iraq. Okay? So it wasn't just discriminated. They were persecuted. Hundreds and thousands of people were tortured and killed. Okay? So that leadership then, under the Saddam regime, knew how to move oil. They knew how to run schools. They knew how to organize a police department. So when you saw Daesh, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, is actually controlling cities with 2 million people like Mosul. Okay? Who could do that? Because they had the governmental expertise, because that whole level. So those people knew about front companies, about which
and
banks.
And people should just remember that under Saddam Hussein, the entire civil service, if you will, apparatus was Sunni.
Yes. Well, no, that's not true. But
the
highest levels were mostly, but there were many Shia that just cooperated, but they were Ba'athists.
Right.
Okay? And so the expertise, the technocrats, then, okay, yeah, we can sell that oil. We know how to do it. We know who. So there's a Turkish company that we're looking at that is buying the oil at half price. and then they're looking to. Yeah. The truth is, and I'm not an expert, but I believe that chemically, scientifically, you can determine where every drop of oil, which oil well it comes from, or which oil field. Because they all have some chemical signature
that is right. Unique.
So if let's say an American oil or BP or somebody, you know, then someone approaches them saying, "Hey, I got some oil, and I'll sell it to you for 25% off." There is no such thing. It's a commodity. Commodities right. have prices. They're traded right. on spot markets.
Right.
Nobody. So, I mean, if I came to you with a diamond and I said, "I'll sell it to you for half price of its appraised value," you know that I stole that diamond, right? So are companies only caring about their profits? Do they know what Daesh is doing? Do they know that this oil came out of Iraq, you know, or Syria? Yeah. So, but do they care? I guess if they're going to buy it, no. They're saying, "Great, haha! You know, we're going to get a bonus this year. I'm going to take the family to ask."
I mean, is that basically how it works?
Yeah.
I mean, do you get that granular when you start to look into like discovery that Bill Peterson has a relationship with this guy from this Turkish oil refinery, I guess, or oil company, and this guy calls Bill Peterson is like, "I got X number thousand barrels.
I have
25% of the cost." And
I have a copy of an email that the largest bank in France, fifth largest bank in the world, BNP Paribas, admitted in pleading guilty to laundering over $190 billion for Iran and Sudan. And in the email, it's from a high-level compliance officer in Paris who's writing to high-level compliance officers in the United States, and he says, you know, this could be, because what they were doing, they were scrubbing the wire transfers. So if it had the name Iran, or if it had the name Iranian Revolutionary Guard, or if it had the name Sudan, which were supposed to be blocked, they would erase those names manually on the wire transfers they were getting, and they would insert their own name into it, run the wire through New York, and then hand the money over to Iran and Sudan. So there's the email says, you know, there's a potential for reputational or other exposure in continuing to do this. I mean, they published brochures that they gave the Iranians how to doctor the documents, and they held seminars. They instructed all their employees. So they admitted, this is what they admitted in their guilty plea. The email says, this could be damaging, especially in light of the fact that Sudan is hosting Osama bin Laden. His name right there. I don't know. Did they know that? Did they care? No, because the other high, and they sent it also to the legal management of the bank. I mean, you're talking the highest level of legal and compliance. And they kept on doing it. So obviously they didn't care, and they were probably... providing dollars for a bank that Osama bin Laden controlled called Bank al-Shamal. And we've sued BNP in Washington, D.C. with that allegation.
And what's the status of that case?
Just started.
Gavi Mairone, thank you so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
All right, folks. Continuing our coverage from Mass Torts 2016 conference in Nevada, Las Vegas, joining me now is Michael Watts. He is an attorney from Mississippi. From Texas.
Right.
And in 2015, you were indicted, charged with, was it fraud in the context of the BP case?
Sure, 95 felony counts, conspiracy, mail fraud, wire fraud, identity theft, aggravated identity theft. The kitchen sink.
All right, so back it up. I mean, you were charged with all these things. How did this? You were going to be part of the BP. You were part of the settlement committee. Just explain to people what that was.
Sure. The oil spill happened on April the 20th of 2010. The oil headed towards an area where I had just represented about 30,000 people who were exposed to formaldehyde in FEMA trailers that they were provided after Hurricane Katrina. We got involved because the oil was headed right to where our clients were. We filed lawsuits on behalf of 40,000 people, and I served on the plaintiff's steering committee that was selected by Judge Carl Barbier to lead the plaintiff's experts, the plaintiff's efforts to bring the case against BP. So we worked on that for 2 years, and then right before the trial, the United States Secret Service raided my offices, forcing me off of the PSC, and then 3.5 years later, we were indicted, and then the case was tried this summer, and we were fully exonerated by a Mississippi jury in Gulfport.
Okay, so I want to back up here. Just for folks who don't know, the steering committee in this instance basically comes up with what is more or less an algorithm or a formula for compensation for people who may have lost livelihood or in various different measures, right, terms of the oil spill?
Yeah, multi-district litigation is designed to put all of the different lawsuits from a particular incident in one court and to organize them to conduct consolidated pretrial discovery so that all the plaintiffs have the benefit of discovery depositions that are taken. And the benefit to the defendant is they don't have to give depositions 500,000, 10,000 times, right? And part of that plaintiff's steering committee is that they are cloaked with the authority from the court to negotiate with the defendants to try to achieve a settlement. In this particular plaintiff's steering committee, it was segregated into the trial team and the settlement team. I was on the trial team and didn't have anything to do with the settlement.
I see. Okay. And so, all right, so... So what? So you represented yourself? Is that?
I did.
Okay. My dad's an attorney, and the one thing he told me all the time, which apparently was an Abraham Lincoln quote, is something to the effect of, "If you have yourself for a lawyer, you have a fool for a client."
Right.
Okay. Well, before we get to that, let's back up. What? Why do you think that this? You were exonerated of all the charges. Why do you think these charges were brought?
You know, this is my first foray into criminal law, but a case brought in federal court has the imprimatur of the United States government, but really throughout the United States there are district attorneys or United States attorneys' right. offices that are really just, you know, the equivalent of private law firms all throughout the United States. And so the indictments are only as good as the leadership in that particular law firm, or the United States Attorney for the Southern District of Mississippi in this case. And there was a gentleman by the name of John Dowdy who had a history of going after lawyers.
I think as well, no, you're a big Democratic donor.
Yeah, I mean, over the years, I've contributed $7.5 million to Democratic candidates, had the president in my house, and I guess that made me a mark to a certain extent. But it was clear that everybody they interviewed, the fact that I was involved politically was a major factor in his energy in going after me, you know.
How long has he served as the USA in that?
Well, he was the criminal division chief assistant United States attorney under the Bush administration. In 2008, when President Obama won the election, there was a 2 or 3 year period where there was no replacement because, you know, Senate log jams and the thing. So the chief judge of that district, Judge Louis Garola, who was also my trial judge, appointed Dowdy as the interim United States attorney. Eventually, the senators got through with what they were doing. There was a new U.S. attorney, so he was put back in as the criminal division chief. But he was in charge during the investigation. And he maintained his status as being the prosecuting attorney in this case for over 4.5 years. And then for whatever reason, 2 months before the trial, he quits. We get a memo that says John Dowdy's no longer with the United States Attorney's Office. And so two new guys had to come in and pick up the ball and try the case. It was very odd.
Oh, wow. I mean, just give me a sense of what this experience was like. I mean, are you dealing with this with years? I mean, you knew you were under investigation, or?
Yeah, I mean, it was a deal where literally between the fall of 2010 through February of 2013, all I'm doing is working on the BP case. And we are 15 days away from trying the case, and then all of a sudden all hell breaks loose and your offices are raided and you're on every newspaper in America. And there certainly appears to be a psychosis in this country that's kind of guilty until proven innocent. So you go through some very public shaming, isolation, everybody assuming, well, they wouldn't be investigating him if he didn't do it. And then when the indictment comes, it's even worse. And so I had to learn a lot about criminal law in a hurry because the way that they indicted the case, it was very clear that they were, you know, indicting enough felonies that it would put me away for the rest of my life for something I did not do, which is a very intimidating process, especially in light of the fact that there was a clear political agenda, at least under the Bush DOJ, to go after very prominent trial lawyers.
Yeah, I mean, I think
some of the biggest trial lawyers in the United States spent time behind bars, and this is kind of a continuation of that ethos and that thinking, I think.
In fact, there was, I mean, that was, I think people will recall, and I think it was in 2005, when the firing of attorney generals,
sure,
who were not pursuing both cases like this and supposed voter fraud cases. That's when a lot of the accusations that Karl Rove was using the Department of Justice, particularly the U.S. attorneys in the states, as
political weapons.
Political weapons, yeah. Essentially.
And it was real clear to me, both from the seven U.S. attorneys that were fired during that time frame, that there was a concerted agenda to go after prominent trial lawyers that were bringing cases against corporate America. And they took down some of the most successful lawyers in this country. And, you know, it's a very intimidating process to have the United States government with all of its might and all of its resources coming after you. In my case, they interviewed over 1,400 people. And they didn't write down what they learned. They withheld all sorts of information, and so they're building a house of cards that's based on untruths, trying to get a conviction, get a notch on their belt, and take out another Democratic funder.
What happened to the cases that you were pursuing against BP?
Well, they were all put through the same process, and the ones that were meritorious, got paid, and the ones that weren't, and there were problems with them. There's no doubt the people that sent me these cases stole a lot of money and then covered it up. And so it's clear there was a massive fraud. It just wasn't orchestrated by me, but the government did not care. The people who did this had done it before, and I didn't know about this.
So, can you give us...
There's a gentleman by the name of Robert Arledge, who's a Mississippi lawyer that was sentenced to 6.5 years in prison based on the testimony of a gentleman by the name of Greg Warren, who is a Baptist minister over there that works in the legal field. And Warren just pointed sideways when he'd gotten his hand caught in the cookie jar manufacturing records in the FinFin litigation. Well, instead of, you know, prosecuting him, he's not a big name, they let him roll over on a lawyer, which is fine, I guess, except that he got a 2-year probated sentence and wasn't even, as a condition of probation, told to stay out of the legal field. I mean, Mike Milken can't trade junk bonds anymore, but Greg Warren can continue to work in the legal field after he committed fraud.
So I can explain to our audience, these fraudulent applications, when you have a mass torts like this in a multi-district jurisdictional case, there are basically agents or franchisees who have that relationship where they are finding the cases and putting them into the class, more or less. And
yep,
that's done through an application process. And these people creating the applications were fabricating facts about the individual's circumstances so that they would be eligible for this case.
Yep.
And so you use this guy as one of...
I used a law firm that used this guy, and it was all a big fraud, and this guy ripped off a bunch of money, and instead of just admitting it to hide his theft, he made up a bunch of people and literally went into people's some publicly available databases and lifted Social Security numbers and personal identifiers. So there was a massive fraud, but it was performed by the guy that the government had already let go before And in fact, John Dowdy, who was responsible for the prosecution of me, was the guy in charge of the restitution payments from Greg Warren on the previous case where he'd let him go.
Interesting.
And I didn't know about any of this.
So these fraudulent cases came upstream from you.
Sure.
And then filtered in. Was there any, did you ever come across any relationship between that U.S. attorney and BP, or was that sort of incidental?
Well, what I know is the chairman of the board of BP is from Mississippi. I know that this prosecutor had a long political history in Mississippi. I know that lawyers from BP in Washington, D.C. were seen meeting with John Dowdy on several occasions before this indictment happened. And then the other interesting thing was is literally we thought it had all gone away. The investigation had stopped for over 2 years. And I thought that the Justice Department had done the right thing, read all the documents, saw that we weren't involved, and was just going to, you know, focus on the people that were. But a United States Senator, Ron Johnson from Wisconsin, last July writes a letter to the Attorney General of the United States, Loretta Lynch, accusing her of declining to press charges against me because I was a Hillary Clinton bundler, and insinuating that she was giving me special treatment and demanding that I be indicted. And within 60 days of that letter, there's a sealed indictment that comes down. I find out about the letter through a conservative blog called the Washington Free Beacon. And they find out about an unsealed indictment before I do. So I don't want to sound schizophrenic, but it sure felt like everybody was out to get me.
Wow.
It was odd.
Where are you now with this type of prosecution? You've gone from sort of a simply vague awareness of how things work within criminal law. There's plenty of examples, not necessarily in cases like this, but of prosecutorial overreach.
Sure.
For cases that might be high profile, whether it's, we've seen it with, there was a famous case, Aaron Swartz, up
sure.
in Boston. Prosecutors who are looking, what, dispositionally, where are you now in this?
I care a heck of a lot more about the criminal justice system than I did before. I'm somewhat embarrassed that, I've been practicing law for 27 years and never really cared about the criminal justice system. And in the last two, I've learned that the Seventh Amendment is important for civil cases, but the Sixth Amendment, protecting our liberty, is really important. Thank God for the jury system. But there's been all sorts of examples of this United States Department of Justice failing to go after large bankers that plundered the economy for $18 billion. Only one guy's gone to jail for the 2008 meltdown. They've come after all sorts of lawyers, particularly mass tort lawyers. And that's concerning. What's also concerning is the way they do it. They come to your friends and your colleagues and they threaten them. They took one of my paralegals out of my offices, and I didn't know any of this at the time, threatening her with life in prison, putting her in a room for 2 hours, can't call anybody. They interview her for 6 hours. Nobody takes any notes. They completely just ignore all of the exculpatory information she gives and write down a couple of the things she says she's concerned about.
How do they
about.
Not take notes? Isn't that a standard operating procedure that there has to be a record?
I would imagine
there's a videotape or a recording.
There's not, and that's just stunning because it's clearly an effort to sanitize all of the not guilty stuff out of the record and just come up with the stuff that's harmful. And so they'll not take notes. They'll make them sign a little statement that just has the two or three things that are helpful to the prosecution, haul them in front of the grand jury, get it all locked down with leading questions, and then just start building a case, witness after witness like that. And it was just outrageous what they did. And they did not want a just verdict. They wanted a conviction of somebody that had some notoriety so they could add another notch to their belt. And what these prosecutors don't realize is that they are destroying people's lives. My daughter is good friends with one of Roger Clemens' son. And, what those kids go through while their parents are on trial for something they did not do is just it's life changing, and it destroys a lot of families. Also, a prosecutor who can commit all sorts of prosecutorial misconduct, as would happen in my case, hiding witnesses, hiding evidence, not disclosing this, dumping 4 million pages of stuff on you without telling you what they're going to use. It's all a game to get a conviction. And our federal judiciary has been so conditioned that it's patriotic to be pro-prosecution, which in fact is such an anathema to what our founding roots were. You know, we had that when King George was plucking people off the street and throwing them in jail for no reason. And there is no benefit to fighting crime, trying to convict innocent people. And there's got to be some consequence to prosecutors that literally are trying to take people out just because of their notoriety or their political giving, because that, of course, has First Amendment implications that are just terrifying.
You know? And what is that prosecutor, that former prosecutor, doing now?
Well, he quit. He's since gotten a job with some sort of a drug enforcement thing for the state of Mississippi. He ought to be prosecuting himself for what he did here, but you know, he's no longer working for the United States Attorney. The criminal division chief that took his place was replaced after this trial, and I'm very hopeful that the United States Attorney for the Southern District of Mississippi is at least doing somewhat of a critical self-analysis and putting a mirror in front of everybody that worked for his office, because it was outrageous what they did. And it wasn't even a close call. We spoke to several of the jurors a few weeks after, and not one of them voted to convict. They decided on the first vote as to me, my brother, my paralegal. It was just a case that should have never been brought. And that was the really challenging thing during the trial, is you keep waiting for some shoe to drop, something you're not expecting, and it never comes. And it's obvious to me that what that guy's game was is indict, over-indict, threaten life in prison, wait for people to roll and start pointing sideways at each other. But he didn't give a damn what the facts were.
Wow. Well, Michael Watts, I appreciate you taking the time. Thanks so much
for
telling us your story. One of many stories like that. Paul Miner is one of those stories who...
Good man. He spent 8 years in prison for something that I don't even think was illegal. It was outrageous what they did to Paul Miner. He's a good person and a good lawyer, and he was pursued strictly because he was a major Democratic donor.
This was all the rage, and I guess maybe to some extent in certain jurisdictions still.
Yeah.
I appreciate your time today.
Thanks for having me on.
All right, folks, going to take a quick break, and I'm anticipating perhaps one more guest. If not, we'll move into some sound. But let's take a quick, a brief musical break, and we'll be back in just a moment. All right, thank you, Matt. All right, we're back, continuing our coverage of the Mass Torts Conference 2016 from Nevada, Las Vegas. Joining me now is Elizabeth Graham. She's an attorney with Grant Eisenhofer and from Wilmington, Delaware. And Elizabeth, you've been handling a case involving Assure.
Yes, that's correct, Sam. We've got we represent approximately 900 women in what has just become a California coordination. The case involves Assure's permanent birth control device that has been on the market since 2002, and we believe was rushed through FDA approval, and there have been some 44,000 complaints, adverse event reports that were never sent to the FDA. So just in February of last year, the FDA put a black box warning, which, as you know, is the strongest warning that a device can carry, suggested a black box warning for the device and came out with a much more stringent criteria for reporting and post-market surveillance. The 900 and some women that I represent have suffered awful injuries as a result of this device.
All right, before we get to the injuries, explain to people how this is supposed to work, because I'm not even sure that our audience understands the dynamic between the FDA and the maker. This was made by this is Bayer.
It is owned by Bayer now, but it was actually, the device is a permanent birth control device, and it's essentially two coils that were supposed to be implanted into a woman's fallopian tubes to prevent conception. The company that originated the device was a small startup in California called Conceptus. Bayer bought that company and then monetized the device.
And so at what stage does it go through FDA approval, and what is involved in that? And just explain that dynamic, because I think when you say, like, there were 44,000 complaints,
right,
and it just wasn't passed on to the FDA, I think there's a lot of people saying, like, wait, what?
Yeah.
Is that how it's supposed to work?
It is definitely not how it's supposed to work. So when a medical device is introduced, it goes through a series of clinical trials, you know, test trials, to make sure that the device is working the way it's supposed to.
And I don't mean to interrupt you, but these clinical trials, they're measuring efficacy or safety or both?
Both. Both. So the clinical trials, they implant the device into women in a study, volunteers, and they measure the efficacy for the prevention of pregnancy, as well as the safety of the device, and whether or not the device, the issue with this device is, does it remain implanted, does it prevent the pregnancy, and does it do any harm to the woman as a result of the implantation? Those reports are supposed to go to the FDA as part of the pre-market approval process. The FDA looks at the clinicals, they look at the data support surrounding the device to make a determination as to whether or not the device should be approved. It's a Class 3 device, which means it's one of the most serious.
So it's a higher level of scrutiny,
exactly,
and a higher set of standards in terms of what establishes its both of its efficacy and its safety.
Correct.
Who performs those clinical trials?
So the manufacturer of the device, in this case it would have been Conceptus, is responsible for performing the clinical trials. But it doesn't end there. Anything that is adverse during the approval process and the trials obviously needs to be reported to the FDA. The FDA regs also require the manufacturer or the owner of the device, which became Bayer, to follow up on the device. Just because something doesn't go wrong in a clinical study doesn't mean that down the road the device has been approved, we got pre-market approval, we're good to go. If there are adverse events subsequent to the device being introduced into the market, it's supposed to be reported.
How does the FDA know? How do they determine the legitimacy of the clinical studies? When they look at the data, are they just looking at the data? Are they looking at the methodology? Are they looking at both those things?
They're looking at both of those things. And they, you know, the staff at the FDA mirrors the staff who's doing the clinical trials. They're scientists and physicians and the like. And so under the FDA's regulatory scheme, you know, manufacturers of the device are held to a very strict standard. And they're supposed to report correctly. And if they don't, if anything has gone wrong in the reporting or in the manufacturing, if there's any deviation from this very strict set of criteria that is the regulatory scheme, it's supposed to be reported and the FDA is supposed to follow up. In addition, the FDA in its own accord can do site visits, can follow up on their own, which, in fact, with respect to Assure, there were several violations that were reported during the manufacturing process after the device was approved, where they deviated from the standard that they were supposed to follow in the actual manufacture of the device.
So the cases that you brought were a function of reports of problems after this process.
Correct.
Was there any, and before we get on to that aspect of it, was there any evidence of the clinical trials not being what they said they were, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. There have actually been women who have spoken out who participated in the clinical trials. And the way it works is, you know, in addition to the medical exams that the women undergo, they're supposed to report their experience. There were some women who participated in the clinical trials, you know, in like case number 1, 2, 3, and a report was submitted to the FDA. These women have now come forward and said, no, I was patient 1, 2, 3, and that is not what I said. I had problems with the device. I had pain. I had excessive bleeding. This is not all of it. And what Bayer's response has been is, you know, oh, well, we didn't determine that at the time to be a function of the device. It was something else that was going on, and they've come.
They're
up
not
with,
supposed to do that, are they?
They are not. There's
right. That's not the. That is specifically the kind of determination they're not supposed to make.
Correct. It's supposed to be an objective. Here are the facts, and the FDA is supposed to interpret it. Not a. Well, we don't think, as the manufacturer or as the owner now of the company, that's relevant. That's not their determination to make, and that's not how the approval process is supposed to work.
What were some of the injuries that your clients suffered?
The vast majority of the clients that I represent have had their fallopian tubes perforated, their uterus perforated. They've had to undergo full hysterectomies at a young age, which, you know, the onset of menopause ensues. And you have to remember, this device was marketed to women as, you know, no muss, no fuss, no surgery required. And so these women were going in, my clients were going in thinking this is a safer alternative to a tubal ligation. And it was touted as being more effective. In reality, a lot of my clients actually did get pregnant or suffered an ectopic pregnancy because the device didn't work. Or for my clients wherein the device did work, it migrated, and these little coils would break off and perforate the fallopian tube, the uterus. So now they're having multiple surgeries, as opposed to if any of my clients had known, well, there's been, you know, tens of thousands of reports of migration. Obviously, that's not an alternative for birth control that they would have chosen.
Right.
A lot of these women have suffered serious allergies. The device is coated in PET fiber and nickel. And a lot of my clients have suffered serious allergic reactions to the nickel, to having these metals in their body. They've lost their hair. There have been reports of women losing their teeth. What's telling to me is that, you know, when thousands of women come forward and complain about the same things, and then they have the device removed and they have to go through all these surgeries, and then their symptoms subside, you know, I think there's clearly a causal connection. And I'm thinking that, you know, this litigation is just beginning, and Bayer has been trying at every avenue to get the cases dismissed.
Right, because once a couple of cases, what is the status? Have you these cases been resolved?
No. So the FDA acted. So we've been working on this case for a couple of years, but honestly, under our legal scheme, there's a huge legal hurdle to bringing cases where a Class 3 device has been approved. And the reason being is if you go, as a corporation, if you go through all these hoops and you prove that your device is safe, you know, that gives you some
level of immunity, presumably,
correct.
Right? But
the process wasn't set up so that you could, you know, get approval fraudulently and then move forward
How
with selling the device.
How is that determined? Like, does the FDA, I mean, I would imagine that one piece of the evidence is the FDA is now putting a label on this that they didn't in 2002, which indicates that the FDA is finding that there is problems associated with this that they were, for whatever reason, not aware of in 2002.
Correct.
And then the next step, I mean, that becomes an element of your evidence, I would imagine.
Exactly.
And then the next step is, does the FDA have to find them, or does the FDA have to have a finding that says, like, we have reason to believe that this stuff is that you fraudulently filled out these forms, or that the data was not presented to us in the way that it was supposed to be, or that you have withheld this information? Or is that what you also go in? Is that another element of the case that you're trying to prove in court?
The FDA, that's not a prerequisite for women to bring an action in court. The FDA doesn't need to make specific findings. Obviously, in this case, they held an advisory panel hearing last fall, and they did make specific findings. They have ordered Bayer to do further post-market research and post-market surveillance and report back to the FDA.
But how do you know that's going
to...
I mean,
it's a good question.
It's the first time.
Right. It's the fox in the hen house problem. And one of the, you know, one of the valuable tools that civil litigation plays is we can uncover evidence that sometimes the FDA misses. And so we file these lawsuits. The majority of my clients, there's litigation pending in a few different states, but the majority of the suits are right now in California. And the reason they're in California is because Conceptus was a California company. Bayer was a California LLC until about 5 minutes ago, when after we filed the lawsuits, they decided to leave the state in the middle of the night, pack up and move to New Jersey, literally. But there are thousands of cases being filed in California. On September 30th, one of our judges in Alameda County, at the request of several firms, coordinated the cases for pretrial purposes. And the cases have been assigned to Alameda, which is extremely helpful for these women, because now we're in a more unified position, whereas before, Bayer actually did have some success in getting cases dismissed based on the fact that the FDA had approved this device. And
is that, so they'll file some form of summary motion?
Correct.
That says, based upon this particular statute, which says that there's, I mean, what is there? What does it take for you to overcome that summary judgment that would be the exception, I guess, to the rule that if the FDA has approved a Class 3 device?
Right. And, well, in California, we have a narrow carve-out to the rule that basically says negligent failure to warn, which is our theory, you know, the entire theory of the case, will not be preempted. You will not get your cases dismissed if you have a certain set of facts. And we argued the preemption motion in front of Judge Smith in Oakland, and she had, thankfully, you know, the good sense to say yes. Sometimes preemption does apply in these kinds of situations, but here it can't be the case that what we've alleged, assuming we can prove it, would insulate Bayer from liability. You can't just come in and say...
What's the standard of proof that's needed for that determination, right? Because you're making some assertions here,
right,
that the preemption would not exist, that you do have the opportunity to bring this case forward. What's the standard of proof that you need? Obviously, you're not proving the case.
Right.
You're proving what is the threshold? How does that work?
Well, at this moment, at this stage in the litigation, a motion to dismiss in California is known as a demur. And basically what it is they're asking, under any set of facts, on the pleadings, on what we've said, even if we could prove it, our case should get thrown out. The standard in California is, if, assuming you take the allegations as true, assuming those allegations that we've put in our complaint are true, would the case be able to survive? And the judge has said yes, in this case it would be able to survive. We also withstood a challenge, and ironically Bayer came in and said, well, even if we did something wrong, it was so long ago that the statute of limitations excludes these women. In other words, their cases are time barred. And the judge had the good sense to say, until the FDA uncovered this, until all these women came forward, there's no possible way, even if a woman had to have a hysterectomy or had to have her fallopian tubes removed or had all of these other awful symptoms, how is she supposed to know that it was associated with it when Bayer was telling the whole world, our device is safe, it's been given the standard of, you know, the gold seal, if you will. What's also interesting about this case is there's been bipartisan legislation proposed in Washington to take this device off the market. There's a pending law, the Alice Grace Law, that has to do with, you know, how these devices are marketed to women and how, you know, women are essentially being used as guinea pigs in certain situations. And Assure is just the clearest example that I've seen in, you know, recent years.
So you have yet, have you moved into discovery on any of this at this point?
We have not. Unfortunately, so as I said, the cases were coordinated.
Right.
So right now we're in a process that was September 30th. We're in the process of getting all of the cases into one court. The JCCP, which is our panel that handles coordinated litigations in California, has stayed all of the litigation. We had discovery ordered in Oakland, and we were planning to move forward with depositions. Right now that's in a holding pattern until all of the cases get in front of a judge. We have a hearing set on December 16th. And at that point, we're hoping we can hit the ground running and really start to get some of the information that these women are entitled to.
Just to round out the context, how much business has this product? I mean, how many? Are we talking millions of dollars of sales?
No, we're talking
billions.
tens of, if not hundreds of millions of dollars in profit. We know that there were hundreds of thousands of these devices implanted in women. So Bayer has made a small fortune off this product. We also know that the vast majority of these women that the device was marketed to were women who could not afford tubal ligations. So there was a certain subset of women who have been, exposed to this device as a result. And then if you take a look at, not only the cost of the surgery, which is not inexpensive, the cost of the device, which is not inexpensive, now these women are suffering having to have multiple surgeries. Mm. And oftentimes their insurance just simply won't cover it. So it's been a real problem. And, these women are suffering economically as well as physically, and Bayer has just made, a fortune off this device. Bayer has no competition. That's the other really interesting thing about this. This is the only permanent non-surgical permanent form of contraception. And so Bayer essentially had a monopoly on this marketplace. And until this past year, when all of this started to come to light,
It was off to the races.
Exactly. And it's their profit over women's health.
Elizabeth Graham from the firm Grant and Eisenhofer, thank you so much for your time
today.
Thank you
so much for the opportunity to talk.
And just so that people are clear, it's Essure, E-S-S-U-R-E. Would you recommend anybody use that product?
Never. Absolutely never. If anybody came up to me now and said, well, my doctor says it's safe, I'm going to say, your doctor needs to know what the FDA is just now uncovering.
Wow. All right. Well, thank you so much for your time
today.
I really appreciate it. I hear when I am here at this conference, I hear these stories, everywhere, frankly.
Sam.
Yes.
And we were just saying here, though, that if you don't like it, you should just buy another birth control device, obviously.
This is a prime example of both the dynamic of, how would this work if there was no FDA, right? Our libertarian friends would say, well, there'd be a private FDA that would sign off on this. I guess the dynamic would be sort of like we had with the ratings agencies for mortgage-backed securities, let's say. Except for in this instance.
See, that worked.
Yeah. Yes. And it also is indicative of, we don't even have the resources for an FDA to be more rigorous in making sure that these companies can't fabricate data, that there's that they're on top of these problems. I mean, in many respects, that's what, I guess I say this every time I come here, but to a large extent, the lawyers who come here are basically like deputies for these regulatory agencies, for attorney generals across the country. They're deputies who are essentially, they're incentivized by making money off it, obviously. Although I have to say, a lot of the people here are not only extremely dedicated in terms of the actual work, but also have a very jaundiced perspective, understating here, of corporate America and maybe just corporations broadly speaking, because they see the worst of it. And they go into discovery and they look at these documents and see, right, I mean, firsthand, that executives at these companies are aware of either the harm that their product is causing, they're aware that they don't have the data to, you know, and from there it's just varying degrees. Like, they're ignoring the data. So again, I don't know the data because I'm ignoring the data. And in some instances, they know the data. But the pressure or the desire for massive profits, and they know, like, you know, at the end of this case, like, you know, we're going to track this case over the years. And at one point, they're going to get into discovery, and Bayer is going to either lose a series of cases, or even before it gets into that, negotiate a settlement. And it's going to be for hundreds of millions of dollars. And it's going to be it's just simply going to be part of their non-fixed costs. They roll out a product, they make hundreds of millions of dollars over the course of X many years. Then at the end of that, some of their expenses are then paid out in terms of compensation to the people that they've harmed. And of course, I imagine many of these women would much rather not have the harm. I would imagine vast majority of people in general would rather not be harmed than receive compensation for that harm.
But this is the process by which we get to solve AIDS. So think about it.
There you go. All right. We're going to take a break and go into the fun half. I'm only going to have about 35 minutes. We went a little bit longer than I thought we would. So let's take a quick break, and I'll take some phone calls and some IMs and do some sound.
Say to never pay.